Thank you very much. Thanks, Kenny. Very interesting for me, because we will see in a minute that also the European approach is, from a conceptual point of view at least, quite similar to the Chinese one, I would say. But there are, I think, some subtle differences in the details. So let me share my screen, assuming that you can see my slides. So, perfect. Wonderful. Again, thanks for having me. Thanks, Alex. Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to be here for the first time at NAB. I will give the European perspective. How does the European Patent Office treat AI and machine learning inventions? Let me see. Who am I? Bastian Best. I'm a European patent attorney. I'm specialized in inventions for digital technologies. So I'm a techie at heart. I studied computer science and I've been a computer nerd all my life, basically. So the only logical conclusion was to become a patent attorney and focus on digital innovations. So that's what I do day in, day out. I've been working for almost 13 years in one of the largest IP firms in Europe, and roughly 2 months ago started my own firm. So pretty exciting times for me, but that's not the topic of today's talk. We will be talking about AI patenting. So here's just for a little bit of context or a little bit of a teaser. One chart I found in an official EPO presentation. So this just shows European patent applications in AI technologies. I'm not sure about the whole data set. They took certain CPC classes, I think. And yeah, it shows the absolute numbers are not so important. Maybe I just want to show you the hockey stick curve. So exponential growth, one could say, just like we have in the technology development as well, also here in the patenting activities, which might surprise maybe some people, because at least my impression is that when I'm talking to practitioners, especially outside Europe, I think the reputation currently really is that the European Patent Office gets really among the tougher jurisdictions for AI patenting. And I'm a little bit sad that I have to agree. I think it's right now it's quite difficult to patent some AI, some classes of AI inventions in Europe. And I don't really agree with the stance the European Patent Office takes in some details, but we will come to that. So how does the approach work on a conceptual level? Well, in the end, it's quite similar than what we've seen from Kenny in China. So we have, of course, the basic hurdles, patent eligibility, and then once that is overcome, the classic hurdle of novelty and inventive step. At the European Patent Office, patent eligibility is really a non-issue. So I sometimes try to show this with some kind of filter analogy. So if we have all of the inventions coming in from the top and the first filter is patent eligibility, almost all inventions go through it. So only, just in China, only the really completely abstract inventions are filtered out at the eligibility hurdle. Only if there is really not a single technical aspect at all in the patent claim. If it's a pure intellectual or purely conceptual algorithmic invention, then it fails at the eligibility hurdle. Much unlike in the US, of course, where at least I see it from the outside, there's still a lot of back and forth on these 101 rejections. So in Europe, one single technical feature in the claim is enough. And that can be a trivial feature. So in the end, it means that apparatus claims are automatically patent eligible because an apparatus is a physical thing. And method claims for processes, the only thing you need is the word computer implemented method. Then the method necessarily uses a computer, which is a technical means, which makes the whole claim patent eligible. So enough to to be said about patent eligibility. Then the next hurdle, inventive step, and this is really the decisive one in Europe. This is the hard one, because especially in the field of AI, that's a high threshold, so to say. Maybe when we get to the Q&A, I would be interested from the US practitioners about my impression. My impression is that this weighing of the two hurdles is quite the other way around as in the US. So at least my impression is that when I work with US colleagues, what I see is that, of course, they get a lot of pushback on 101 rejections. And then somehow my US colleagues tend to work on the claim wording. They tend to insert things like, I don't know, an evaluator engine and things like that, some estimation modules or something like that. And then sometimes they do an interview, a telephone interview with the examiner, and then the 101 rejection is withdrawn. My impression, my naive impression as not a US practitioner is that 101 is very much about the wording in the claim, really. And once that is done, once that is overcome, when in the US you come to non-obviousness, the whole invention is looked at, including the purely algorithmic part of the invention. At least that's my impression. I would be interested in your comments, maybe in the Q&A. In Europe, it's kind of the other way around. Patent eligibility, no issue at all, as I said, and the difficult question is inventive step. Why? Because if we look at an invention, we have the prior art, of course, that's this C here on the bottom. And we have an invention which has to have a certain delta, a certain addition to the prior art, of course. Of course, the question in the end is this delta obvious or is it non-obvious? Does it involve an inventive step, as we say at the European Patent Office? But what the European Patent Examiner does is he doesn't look at the whole delta over the prior art, but he really takes the claim and really, just as Kenny did, divides the claim into technical features and non-technical features. Now, this is a bit of an oversimplification here. So, of course, there are certain features in a patent claim which are inherently technical, which can fall on your foot, like a computer, like a network connection, a cable, wires, something like that. That's all technical, of course, machinery. And, of course, there are inherently non-technical features, like pure algorithms, a pure conceptual idea, a way of sorting numbers, for example. But that's still not the end of the story. The two classes are not that strict in that, or even the non-technical differences can still contribute to the technical character of the invention, as the EPO calls this. So what is important really in the end concerning the algorithmic features is the purpose. What is the algorithm used for? And if the algorithm is used for a non-technical purpose, like, I don't know, forecasting stock market developments, it stays non-technical, so to say. But if the same algorithm is used to forecast, that the screw in the machine will break in a couple of seconds, then the algorithm becomes technical because it serves a technical purpose, and then it gets put into the technical bucket, so to say. And then in the end, for the obviousness question, only the technical difference is looked at. As you see, the question in the end really is, what is technical or not? I already saw the question in the chat for Kenny's part. What is technical and what is not technical? Good question. The EPO leaves that open on purpose, so we don't have any notion of this kind of, what was it, physical order or something in Kenny's presentation. The European patent law and the case law leaves the notion of technicality open on purpose, because they say that technology evolves and so should the case law be flexible. So what we have in the end is really individual cases which we have to study, and which where the boards of appeal have said, well, this is technical and this is not technical. Concerning AI, the control question in the end is, to wrap up the conceptual part, Does the invention solve a technical problem? What does the algorithm do? Does it do something technical? Does it produce a technical effect? Then it contributes to inventive step. Is AI technical then? The logical question. Well, we have also at the EPO guidelines for the examiners, which is like a 1,000-page book with every aspect, every detail about material and procedural patent law in it, the Bible of the for the patent examiner, so to say. And since 2018, the EPO introduced an own section about AI and machine learning into the guidelines. So here, I, as a computer scientist, I was hoping now the EPO will clarify that machine learning is among the most fundamental technologies of our future. But if we look at that section, it says pretty much to my surprise initially that the, let's say, the computational models underlying AI, such as neural networks, k-means, genetic algorithms, things like classification, clustering, training algorithms also. All these computational models in themselves are considered mathematical things, and math as such is excluded from patentability, is regarded as something non-technical. So we can say in the end that in Europe there are at the moment no European patents for innovations in core AI. So if one of your inventors came up with a new a uniquely structured neural network, and if this is completely stunning to any AI data scientist, and if it converges really fast, it has a beautiful mathematic properties, it can be trained very fast, it's not patentable, because at that level the European Patent Office says that's pure mathematics and mathematics cannot be patented. It only becomes technical, it only becomes patentable, this completely unique neural network, if you use it for a technical purpose. If you use it for predictive maintenance in your industrial plant, for example, and if you limit your patent claim to this technical purpose, that's the point. So, bottom line, in Europe, at the moment, no European patents for core AI innovations, but we have to focus on, let's say, applied AI. As soon as AI is applied in a technical context to do something technical, then it becomes patentable. One note, so this, I got 3 minutes to go according to my watch. This statement in the guidelines, there's no case law cited, so this was introduced in 2018, but I don't agree to this general statement, and I'm always making the argument when I'm fighting with patent examiners, well, machine learning in itself, the task of making the computer learn autonomously from experience and adapt its function autonomously based on this experience, this is something technical. This is the solution of a technical problem. The problem of machine learning is technical. That would be my opinion, but well, the EPO doesn't share this opinion right now. So yeah, I would really encourage you to, if you instruct your European councils, let them go on appeal. Let them take the cases on appeal, so that over time, hopefully, we get a more fine-grained case law, and we overcome this generic statement. So, no European patents for core AI, but we have to look at applied AI. Now, I still haven't answered the question, what is applied AI then? And as I said here, we have to know the case law. There are a number of application scenarios where AI is technical. If it controls a system or a technical process, of course, think of self-driving cars, drones, robotics, industrial automation. Here, chances are pretty high that there's no issue, there's no question about whether the AI contributes to the technical character. It's just about non-obviousness then. Image processing, for example, is accepted as a technical field. Think of face recognition, medical analysis, things like that. Language processing, data coding, compression algorithms, although they are mathematical, if they are used to encrypt messages and improve the security of electronic communication, it becomes technical. On the other end of the spectrum, mathematical methods as such, business methods, of course, core AI, as I said, Text classification is interesting, is considered to be non-technical at the EPO as compared to image processing. And of course, purely virtual simulations. So if everything happens on a just inside the computer without any real life input, without any real life output, and without any particularly clever implementation, if it's just purely virtual, that's also non-technical. So pretty elaborated catalog at the EPO. There's much more to say about it. I could talk for a day about the case law, of course, but in the end it comes down to the individual case. I would say if you use the AI for something that can fall on your foot, so to say, chances are good that you can patent it. If it's more on the virtual side, it gets difficult.